Good morning, everybody. Welcome to The Live.
Hello.
My name is Caroline.
My name is Tanya.
We are so glad you're here. Well, since we introduced ourselves, right. We would love for you to introduce yourself.
Yes.
So go ahead and tell us who you are. You can do it in the chat room.
Yeah.
You can click the scan the QR code.
Yeah, that'll take you straight to our digital connection card. That's just a great way for us to get to know who you are. We want to connect.
Yeah, for sure. So today we have a very special event. We have a hot cocoa bar out in the lobby. So we would love for you to join us if you would like. You can come to the 11 o'clock.
You still have time.
Yeah, yeah. Or you could DIY it at home. You can do your own hot cocoa bar. We would also love that too.
Post it on social media and tag us on social media. We have Instagram, Facebook. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Just a bunch of ways to connect.
Yeah.
And then, hey, if you are missing Hot Cocoa Day today, what's next Sunday?
We have Ugly Christmas Sweater Day
next
Sunday.
We are pumped, and we want you to come be a part of it. If you're competitive, you don't want to miss this because there is going to be a winner.
Yeah.
And if you can't make it in person, post something on social media, tag us.
Bonus points if you DIY it,
yes.
too.
Give us a little OOTD.
Yeah. And a video. You can send us a video.
Send
That's
us
cool,
a video.
Too.
We want to see your ugly Christmas sweaters. We are ready for Christmas. We hope you are. And then another big day here at The Lift is December 17th. What's that?
So basically, December 17th, we have an event called Giving Hope.
Yep.
It's basically, like I said, an event that families can come in with if they're low income, and they can come pick out gifts for their kids.
Yeah.
So if you'd like to find out more information about that, you can scan the QR code and
There's a couple different ways that you can be a part of it. You can volunteer in person. You can walk families through the shopping experience. You can wrap some gifts. I love wrapping gifts.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is about it, but it just puts me in the Christmas spirit. So come do that while also serving the church. Or you can sponsor a child. And this is really cool because if you're not local, maybe you're watching from another state, another country, you can sponsor a child and still be a part of Giving Hope. So
Caroline
said, scan the QR code for more information.
Yeah, for sure. So the next day, December 18th, we have another very important event. We just have a bunch of busy
events.
December
is big, yeah.
Yeah, busy month. So anyways, December 18th is Baptism Sunday.
We are pumped.
Yeah, so if you would like to find out more information about that, you can scan the QR code with that as well. Pastor Lance likes to describe it as an outward expression of an inward faith.
And guys, this is the last baptism of the year here at The Lift. So if in 2022 you made that decision to follow Christ and you have not yet been baptized, like, now is your chance to get that, to publicly profess your faith. So we are excited about that. And then we are pumped for service today. We have a special guest leading us in worship, Pastor Justin Kenley. We love him, and we love that he is leading us today. And then Pastor Lance is kicking off a brand new sermon series called The Greatest Gift. What is the greatest gift, you might ask? Well, stay tuned.
That's right.
For the next couple of weeks, Pastor Lance is going to be walking us through that. Follow along through with the message through the app. You can see all the notes for the sermon. Well, we are pumped to get into worship. We've got to set our hot chocolate down. And we are excited to worship. Thank you guys for joining us. We hope you enjoy.
What's up, church family? Why don't you stand with us as we sing and worship and celebrate the birth of our Savior?
While shepherds kept their watching, o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light.
You know, I'm grateful to think about the hope of Christmas, but I'm so grateful that our hope did not end in a manger. But Jesus lived, he died, and he rose again. And so we're going to sing, "You Keep Hope Alive." Let's sing this out. And days may be darkest, but your light is greater. You light our way, God, you light our way. When evil is rising, you're rising higher with power to save, with power to save. Here's our living hope, let's sing. You keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive. Oh, come on, let's sing. Hey. Death had a stronghold, but your life was stronger. Rose from the grave, rose up from the grave. Yes. When evil is rising, you're rising higher. With power to save, with power to save. I know sometimes it's hard to sing those songs and types of songs because you might feel like you're in a hopeless situation right now. You might feel like hope is dead, but I'm so thankful over the pages of Scripture how God continually delivers His people from hopeless situations. He's the same God. Let's sing. I'm calling on the God of Jacob, and whose love endures through generations. And I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, and the one who opened up the ocean. And I need you now to do the same thing for me.
Oh, listen.
blessing. This is a prayer. We need him this morning. And oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. And oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. Sing, I'm calling.
And I'm calling on the God of Mary, and whose favor rests upon the lowly.
I love this line right here.
Cause I know in you all things are possible.
Oh, I'm calling.
Cause I'm calling on the God of David, shepherd boy courageous.
Oh, with all the confidence we got.
Cause I may not face Goliath, oh, but I've got my own giant. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. It's how I need you now. It's oh rock of ages, I'm standing.
Sing all these things that our God still does. I want to encourage you. If any of these lines are true for you, let's just encourage one another and raise our hands as we sing it. If you sing God answer prayers or move, let's declare this together. You heard.
Cause you heard your children then, and you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same.
Has he answered prayers in this room?
Cause you answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. Cause you are the same God. You
I'm thankful he's provided in my life.
Cause you were providing then, and you are providing now. Cause you are the same God.
You are the same God.
Cause you moved in power then, and God moved in power now.
You are the same God.
You are
His word says that he holds our life breath in his hands. So he's faithful just to give us breath to sing. He's faithful to give us breath to worship him and to be in the room this morning. I'm thankful that he hears us when we call. Amen. So sing, I'm calling. And I'm calling on the Holy Spirit. And almighty river, come and fill me again. And come and fill me again. Come and fill me again.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Your glory, God,
your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory.
So much for meeting us here this morning. We love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Yeah, amen. Hey, give him. Yeah. Yeah, thank you, team. Thank you so much. Church, you can be seated. Man, can you believe it's Christmas time already? This is my favorite time of the year. How about it for you? Yeah? Yeah, some of you are Scrooges. Yeah, I'm gonna try my best to win you over the next few weeks. I love Christmas. I really do. It's my favorite time of the year. Good news, parents. Good news. You no longer have to wonder what your kids want for Christmas. They now give you a spreadsheet. Or maybe they're like mine and they send you a note from Apple, you know, one of those Apple notes that they share, and that way that they can update it on a regular basis so that when they see something that they like, it's always fresh on the list, right? Does anybody else have that same blessing? Anybody in here? Am I the only one? Maybe we got a few out there, but I love it. Used to, you wondered what to buy your kids. No more. Now, us men, we just stress over what we're going to get our wives, right? That's a hard one. That's a stressor. Like right now, I'm going to have to remove this from the notes. Because I start feeling the tension the moment I think about, what am I going to get Andrew for Christmas? Oh, my goodness. Well, you know, you hear that this is the most wonderful time of the year, but yet I know that for some, it doesn't feel that wonderful. And there are all kinds of reasons why. It could be just the stress, the financial stress of figuring out how you're going to pay for Christmas. It could be the hectic schedules, because let's just be honest. Christmas schedules are difficult. Trying to balance all different sides of the family and hit all the Christmas parties, whether they're at church or work or whatever it may be. Maybe for you it's an unexpected doctor's report that
came in and the news has just not been good. I know those are out there. Or a sudden loss of a loved one. Something like that could be overshadowing the gift that Christmas is. Because that's what it is. Christmas is a gift. And if you don't like what Christmas is giving you right now, what I'm going to make a suggestion to you that over the next several weeks, you begin to exchange it. Okay, you exchange it. That's what we're going to do. We're going to exchange gifts this year. I love gifts. I really love, that's like one of my favorite parts about Christmas is opening up presents. I go back in my mind to my childhood days. One of my favorite experiences of Christmas was going over to Grandpa and Grandma's house. We would go there on Christmas Eve night. And Grandma, the way that she did it when I was a kid, she had this room. I don't know if your grandmas have this, but she had this room. It was off limits for the entire month of November and December because, like, that's where all the gifts were, all right? And Grandma would go into that room. It's like the Holy of Holies, you know, because she'd go in there, and I don't know how she would do it, but she would come out, and her arms would just be full of gifts. And what she would do is she would bring out gifts individually for the grandchildren. And so you just couldn't wait for your turn. I'm like, I just couldn't wait, you know. Is it my turn yet, Grandma? Is it my turn yet? You know, and she would come out, hands full of gifts, and lay them in the floor. And I'm like, is that for me? It's like, she's like, yes, they're all for you. And I could just tear into them, and everybody's watching. I mean, I still remember that experience. I love those gifts. And I'm sure you do too. I'm sure you love gifts. Probably some that you don't love necessarily are the gifts that you get, and you're like, what is this? You know, I didn't ask for this. Well, I can't use this. What is this for, right? I mean, some of us, we get gifts like that, things that we don't need or don't want or can't use. And maybe that's how you feel about Christmas right now. It's giving you something that you don't want, you don't need. And so what I want to do is to encourage you to bring what it is that you don't want and give it to God and allow Him to give you something that you need. Let me tell you where we're going to go over the next several weeks, okay? Today, what we're going to do is we are going to look at those things in our life that concern us, our worries. And I'm just going to ask you, just honestly, just to wrap up those worries, whatever it is that keeps you awake at night, you're not sleeping, whatever it is that just, it's there, it makes you sick at the pit of your stomach, you just can't get it out of your mind, and it's, whatever that is, I'm just going to ask you to wrap it up and give it to God today, and allow Him to give you something in return, and that's His peace. You're going to find that today. Next week, we're going to talk about our hurts. Truth is, we all have them. Lots of hurts from our past that we just can't seem to get over. And the encouragement is going to be, okay, let's just give that to God. Let's give it to Him and allow Him to heal us. Because that's it. He can give us this gift of healing if we will allow it. The following week, on the 18th, is probably the most difficult message this Christmas. And it's where we're going to deal with grief. There's a lot of us that are carrying around grief, and we didn't want it, never asked for it. And it's like, what do you do with it? And then I'm just going to simply ask you, bring it to God and allow Him the chance, the opportunity to give you the gift that He gives us at Christmas time, which is a joy that is... the world can't give us this kind of joy. And so the next 3 weeks we're going to do that. On Christmas Eve, I can't stress this enough.
Jesus is the answer to all of our greatest problems. He's the answer. It's all about Jesus. You can't love Jesus too much. You can't think about Jesus too much. You can't thank him too much. You can't depend on him too much. Like, everything is all about Jesus. And he's God's answer to all of our problems. Jesus is. And so on Christmas Eve, we're going to really, really dive into that gift. And of course, you already know he's the greatest gift of all. And we're going to see that. We're going to see that come Christmas Eve. So today, here's the idea. I just want you to be thinking and asking, okay, God, what is it? What are those things that I'm worried about? What are those things right now that are overshadowing the gift of Christmas, the joy that's in the air? Like what is it? And I'm going to ask you to just give it to the Lord and receive from him his peace. And we're going to look at this together. Jesus talked a lot about worry. In fact, if you will open up your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6, we're going to look at a sermon where Jesus talked about worry. Now, if you have the Lyft app, this is how I would encourage you to work through today's message. If you will open up that app, you can actually find today's sermon notes. It's all there, and there's some fill in the blanks. And it's really cool because you can fill in the blank, and if you get it wrong, it won't let you. It will put in the right answer. And at the very end of the message, you can email that thing to you and you can have a copy of today's message and you can work through it in your quiet time or whatever that might be. I think there's going to be some things that are going to help you in regards to worry. All right, that's the goal today, is to really help you understand how is it that what do you do with this? What do you do with worry? So let's go to Jesus. Let's look at his words. Matthew chapter 6. We'll start with verse 25. This is what Jesus said. It's not my words. These are his. He said, that is why I tell you, now, there's going to be some places where you're going to see some bold words. Those are key words, okay? I want you to look. He says, this is why I tell you what? Not to worry. Jesus is telling you and I not to worry about everyday life. Whether you will have enough food or drink or enough clothes to wear, isn't life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. Now, I love this next line. And aren't you far more valuable to him than they are? That's Jesus saying you are. If he takes care of them, he's going to take care of you. Verse 27 says, can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon, in all of his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are. You know Solomon, the richest man to ever walk the planet here in the biblical days. And Jesus is saying, oh, even him, he didn't have what they have. Verse 30 says, and if God cares so wonderfully and for the wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat or what will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. But your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble is enough for today. Do I have an amen out there on that one? Today's trouble, Jesus said, is enough for today. Your Creator is telling you not to worry. He's saying in this text that worry is not something that's natural. Shouldn't be. Nature doesn't worry. Why are you worrying? In fact, I want you to know something, that worry doesn't change your situation. It only changes you. It doesn't change your situation. But it will have an effect on you. You start putting the worry in, somehow that worry is going to come out. It will manifest itself in some way. It might be that you're short-tempered towards your spouse or towards your kids. It might be that, you know, you blow up on someone on 485 when they're riding in the fast lane and they're slowing down traffic. It might be that it comes out in your health. It's going to come out. It's going to affect you, but it's not going to change your situation. Worry, it's not going to do that at all. In fact, worry is a reflection of our faith. And we're told this by Jesus. Like, as Christians, as saved people, we shouldn't worry. And yet, we do, right? Jesus said these things is what dominates the thoughts of unbelievers. Not people of faith. And yet, as I stand here today, I'm thinking, they dominate my thoughts too. Worry. It's a real issue. How can we give God our worry, right? How do we do that? I want to suggest to you three things today. Three, if you'll just remember these three things, if you'll just remember them, kind of put them in your pocket. When worry comes up, 2 a.m, you're awake and you're just laying there in bed, pull them out, start working through them, and watch and see where your worries go. Here's what I want to do. Let's walk through these things. First one that we see here, and this is all comes from Jesus. All comes from him. Number one is this: let God be God. Let him be God. Oftentimes when we worry, and the reason why we're worrying is because we're not allowing him to be God. I mean, Jesus, he even said it. He said it in verse 33. He says, seek the kingdom of God above all else. That's Jesus saying, no, let's let God be God. It's his job. That word seek there, it carries with it this idea. It's not just, it's seeking to find through our thoughts is the idea, through our meditations. So let me ask you a question. What deserves to be on the throne of your thoughts? I'll give you the answer. It's God. Nothing else deserves to be there. And yet, I wonder how many of us are dominated by them. It's just always there, always on our thoughts. I'll tell you something. When I'm worried, it's because I'm trying to play God. It's because I'm trying to be the one in control. Jesus spent a lot of time trying to help his followers put in perspective on where God should be. In Matthew chapter 22, one came up to ask Jesus, Jesus, out of all the commandments of the law, which is the greatest commandment? He's trying to trick him. Well, Jesus puts in perspective on where we should be when it comes to God. He says, well, I'll tell you. Jesus replied. He says, seek God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Like everything about you. This is the first and the greatest commandment. Jesus said this. He's trying to put in perspective on where it should be. We should be focused on God. And the more that we focus on him, the more that we will trust him. See, you will never trust a God that you're not, that you don't love and that you're focused on. You'll never do that. When God is on the throne, what we're doing and what we're saying is that, God, you're in control. When we start to worry, what we're doing is we're saying, God, we're trying to play your role. And we need to let God be God. You ever had a boss leave and like go out of town, and someone stepped up because they're gone. Someone else steps up and tries to be the boss. You ever had that happen? Aren't they a terrible boss? We are a terrible boss when it comes to our life, especially when it comes to worry. Let God be God. Just let him be God. Jesus said, seek the kingdom of God above all else. Let God be God. Number two is this. Live for today. Live for today. Let God be God and live for today. Some of you, this is what I know about you. You're already into tomorrow. You're already thinking about that to-do list. You're already thinking about, well, okay, what's going to take priority tomorrow morning? No. Live for today. Don't be in tomorrow already. We just get this thing all messed up. That's why Jesus said in verse 34, he says, so don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's troubles is enough for today. It's so important that we understand that God gives us enough power and strength for today, but not for tomorrow. He doesn't equip us to prevent us from all future situations where we don't need him. No, he only gives us what we need, the strength that we need today. That's it. You read the Old Testament, and you would see this oftentimes. You would see, for example, the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 50. He knew this. The prophet Isaiah, he would say in verse 4, he'd say, the sovereign Lord has given me his words of wisdom so that I know how to comfort the weary. And then he said these two words, mourning by what? Mourning. Mourning by mourning. He wakens me and opens my understanding to his will. You know what the prophet Isaiah is saying? He's saying it's morning by morning, each day God has given me his wisdom. But he's only going to give me enough wisdom for today. And tomorrow, when the next day comes, he'll give me wisdom for that day as well. That's what we see in Scripture. Lamentations 3, verse 22 and 23 says, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Every morning. Great is his faithfulness. Every morning, he's got what you and I need. But it's just enough for that day. We need to learn to live for today. Don't get into tomorrow. When we get into tomorrow is where the worry comes. And the only way to change tomorrow is just to start living today. Just live it today. Jesus says, can all your worries add a single moment to your life? I don't know about you. It's never happened for me. The things I worry about never seem to change anything for the better. So how is it that we give our worries to God? We let him be God. We live for today. And then number three, we lean on God's faithfulness. Lean on it. Jesus said repeatedly, aren't you far more valuable to him than the birds? Since God cares for the flowers that are here today and they're thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. He loves you. Those flowers, they're here today. They're gone tomorrow. But you, he certainly cares for you. God already knows all you need. He will give you everything you need. Like, we can lean on his faithfulness. The hard part becomes when you don't know his faithfulness. That's why it's so important for us to read his word, to understand that God is faithful. He's a promise maker and he's a promise keeper. This author, Herbert Locklear, found that there are 7,147 different promises that God makes in Scripture to us. Now, we're going to go through those 7,000. real quick. Here's the thing. When you start to understand the promises, you'll start to lean on His faithfulness. I'll give you some. Did you know that He promises to supply every need that you have? I'm not talking about a new set of golf clubs or a new car or upgrading the kitchen countertops. Okay, that's not a need. But God promises in Scripture, He promises to supply your every need. God has promised that all things will work together for the good of those who love Him and serve Him faithfully. He's promised that in Scripture. God has promised that He will always be good, that He's always with you. He's promised His faithfulness. Hebrews tells us that let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for He who promised is faithful. God is faithful. He's always faithful. God designed you for a purpose. It means He gave you a purpose. That's a promise. He gave it to you. For we know God's handiwork, Scripture says, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. He's given us a purpose. It's a promise for us. God loves you deeply, no matter what. That's a promise. God gives you the power for life. Like he doesn't give you the spirit of fear, but what does He do? He gives you the spirit of power and love and self-control. God gives that to you. God will give you wisdom if you ask. He will not withhold it. God has promised His people eternal life. Like we'll live forever when you say yes to Jesus. Like those are just a few, just a handful of promises. And when you know those promises, you can lean on His faithfulness. It's what helped the Apostle Paul say this in Ephesians 4, verse 6. He says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. We've talked about this verse. Don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all that He has done. In this passage, Paul tells us two things that we can do with our worry. He says to tell God about it. I wonder how many of you, whatever it is that you're worried about, how many of you have told God about it? How many of you have taken the time just to stop, get on your hands and knees and say, God, this is that thing I'm worried about. It's keeping me up at night. It's making me sick at my stomach. God, I need your help. Tell God about it. And then the second thing that Paul says, thank God for what He has done. And I know what some of you right now, you might would push back and say, well, hold on a minute. God's not done anything in it, but about it, because if He had, I would not be worried. He's always working. Paul's very clear to say, thank God for what He has done. He is always, always, always at work. See, that's the power of thanks. It refocuses our mind on the goodness and the gifts of God rather than the problems around us. There's some power there. And when we begin to do that, then verse 7 happens, which Paul says this to the Philippians. He says this, then you'll experience God's peace. If you just tell Him what your needs are, thank Him for all that He has done, then you will experience His peace, which exceeds anything that we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. It will guard. It's like it sets up this a guard around you. It will cover you. Like we can dwell on our problems, or we can dwell on God's promises. What is it going to be for us? I want to choose His promises. As a Christian, as one who says yes to Jesus, when I worry, guess what? It's a sin. It's a sin of not trusting God. And I want to replace it. Like I want you to have my worry. I want your peace. See, when we let God be God, when we stop trying to live into tomorrow and just stay in today, and we lean on God's faithfulness, He'll guard our hearts and our minds with His peace. That's Christmas. Thousands of years ago, God opened up the eyes of the prophet Isaiah just to see that very thing. Listen to his words. He wrote this in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. He said, For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, the greatest gift of all. He's the Prince of Peace. It's why when He was here and walking among us, He said these words. He says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives peace." He says, "Let not your heart be troubled." Like, don't worry. Don't worry. Neither let them be afraid. Jesus, He's the Prince of Peace. He's the Prince of Peace. And He can be the Prince of Peace in your life when you let God be God. Stop trying to play God. Live for today. Enjoy today. We've talked about this year, right? We've talked about one of the greatest enemies, spiritual enemies to our life is hurry. Some of you already, you've already hurried through today and you're on into tomorrow. Stop it. Come back. Live today. And lean on God's faithfulness. No matter what you're going through, He's faithful. He's faithful. If you lost a loved one this week, unexpectedly, He's still faithful. You got a bad report from a doctor. Things look scary. God is still faithful. He's still there. You're concerned about how you're going to take care of Christmas this year. God's still faithful. The next time worry comes your way, think of these three words: let, live, and lean. Can we just say that together? Ready? Let, live, and lean. Let God be God, live for today, and lean on His faithfulness. Will you bow your heads? Close your eyes. Church, close your eyes. I want to ask you, is there something that's keeping you up at night? You having a hard time sleeping? Something that's making you sick at the pit of your stomach? You having a hard time trusting God with it? I want to pray for you. Okay, the Bible says where prayers of a righteous person have great power as they work. And so we here as the body of Christ, we're in this together. If you're here today and you're like, okay, Pastor, yeah, I've got something that I'm worried about. It's dominating my thoughts. But today, I want to exchange it. I want to give this to God, and I'm going to ask Him to give me His peace. If that's you, wherever you are, I want to pray for you. Would you just lift your hand right now? Just lift it up. Just lift it up. Hold it up. Yeah, just hold it up. Just long enough. Let's hold it up for just a moment while I look around. God, I got this thing. God, I want to give it to you in exchange for your peace. Thank you. You can put your hands right back down. Maybe there are others of you, you're here, and when I talk about letting God be God in your life, you don't really understand that, because there's never been a time in your life when you've made him God. See, the way that you make him God is that you surrender your life to Jesus Christ. This Christmas is the great time to do that. Whether you're here in person or you're watching on the other side of a screen, you can say yes to Jesus. It's what Christmas is all about. Christmas is about Jesus, God, coming to us, living this sinless, perfect life. He gave us a gift of salvation. Jesus, he went to the cross. He took on my sin and my shame and your sin and your shame. He took it all on him. He shed his blood for you and for I. He did that so that he could give us life. The thing I love about Jesus is that, yes, he died for our sins, but he didn't stay dead. No, he rose again. 3 days later, he came back to life so that he could put his life right inside of us. And today, he wants to give you life. The Bible says that if we would confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, we could be saved. You can be saved today by simply doing that. And so wherever you are, why don't you just say yes to Jesus right now? Say yes to Jesus. This is how you do it. Just say some words like this. I'm going to lead you through this prayer. Just start with his name. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are the risen Son of God. And Jesus, I know that I am a sinner and I need to be forgiven. And so will you please forgive me of my sins? Today, I am turning from a life of sin to a life surrendered to you. I'm making you Lord of my life. I'm saying yes to you, Jesus. Listen, if that was your prayer just then, Jesus Christ just stepped out of heaven and he stepped right into your heart. Was that your prayer? If it was, I'm going to ask you to do something for me. You got to tell me. You got to tell me. And so I just want to ask you, like I do every Sunday, if you prayed that prayer, would you just lift up your hand right now, wherever you are? Just lift it and lift it up high. Hold it up. There are hands going up. You're not alone. Just hold it up right now. Right back here in the back to my left, God bless you. Thank you so much. Right over here to my right in the back, God, thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for that hand. Thank you so much. Who else? Just lift your hand up. Lift your hand up. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you. You can put your hands right back down. Those of you that are on the other side of a screen, you can lift your hands as well. If you're at online church, just click the little hand-raised emoji. Follow the links that our hosts are placing there, okay? Will you do that? Let's all pray together. Oh, God, thank you for the greatest gift of all. Thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you that you loved us so much that you sent him here to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. Thank you that he became sin on our behalf so that we could be made right with you. Thank you that today there have been people who have crossed that line of faith, who have said yes to you, Jesus. Please help them to know their life has been forever changed. Their eternity is now different. They now have eternal life with you. Wow, they have so much to celebrate. God, I pray that as we leave this place today, that we would leave you with that worry, whatever it is that we carried in. May we just leave it at your feet, and may we walk out of here with your peace, letting you be God, living in today, and leaning on your faithfulness. God, thank you that you love us that much. We give it all to you. We celebrate you today, and it is in the name of Jesus we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Hey, can we just give the Lord a big hand?
Thank you for joining us for Church Online today. We are so excited for this Christmas season, and Pastor Lance kicked off a brand new sermon series today, and it was so good, all about how we need to let God be God. And I love how he said we can either dwell on our problems or we can dwell on God's promise. We have the choice. What are we going to dwell on this holiday season, this Christmas season? And hey, if you said yes to Jesus today, let us know. We want to be a part of that journey with you. We are not called as believers to do life alone. So text the number on the screen, and we want to connect with you. And if you said yes to Jesus, your next step is baptism. And we are baptizing here at The Lift on December 18th. That is going to be our last baptism for 2022, and we would love for you to be a part of it. So thank you guys so much for tuning in. Don't forget to wear your holiday, your Christmas sweaters next Sunday. We hope you enjoyed the service. We love you, and we'll see you next week.